The tsunami saw the Tamil diaspora flock to Sri Lanka. My cousin was one of them. He had managed to raise over $100,000 in a single week and had returned to find out what else could be done. But first, he was on a chocolate mission for some neighborhood kids from America. His old school friend Raviraj was there to help. That was when I first met Raviraj. I liked him immediately, especially his energy and his way with people. He spoke Tamil, English and Sinhala and was able to bridge the ethnic divides. All kinds of people came to speak to him. I traveled often with Raviraj around the island. I always look forward to our trips to Jaffna up the A9 road. During these journeys, Raviraj would entertain me with stories from his past. My favorite one is how he first entered politics. When Raviraj was about to go to Jaffna to run for deputy mayor, his mother refused to let him leave the house. Her anxiety was understandable. The previous two mayors had both been assassinated, allegedly by the Tamil Tigers. Raviraj's mother, knowing that her son strictly observed Hindu customs and practices, positioned herself in front of the doorway, her legs blocking his path. It is forbidden to cross over someone else's legs, especially when they're your mother's. Raviraj was in a dilemma. For hours he agonized, but in the end crossed over to take the first steps of his political career. Raviraj felt that the tsunami, although a terrible disaster, was an opportunity for people to forget their differences and come together as one.
You know, I am always an optimistic personality. I will never think about something coming to stand still. I always see as a positive thing that I want to continue with this, and I feel this peace talk should continue. That would be the outcome of this, and we all will get together and solve our basic problem. Thereby, we can have a united Sri Lanka forever. Okay, yeah.
During the months that followed, I saw less of Raviraj. He felt it was no longer safe for me to travel with him. He shunned security and people said he was taking too many risks with his outspokenness. Raviraj spoke out against everyone. He was particularly critical of the government's decision to close the A9 road, the only land link to the north of the country. Shortly after this interview, Raviraj and his bodyguard Lucky were shot dead in Colombo. His mother's worst fears had come true. I was shocked when I heard the news. The previous evening, he had been protesting outside the UN head office against the killing of 47 refugees in Vaharai by government troops.
He has been a great human rights worker, a peace worker, a person who has stood for a negotiated solution, and who has been very close to the Sinhalese.
I was with thousands of others who were at the tribute rally before his body was taken to his hometown of Jaffna. Everyone had come to pay their respect to the man and what he stood for. I remember thinking how sad it was for Sri Lanka to lose someone like Raviraj, who had unusually reached out to all Sri Lankans, the Muslims, Tamils and Sinhalese.
We want to demonstrate our protest and to ensure that this does not happen in the future.
The assassinations and the culture of impunity continue in Sri Lanka. The number of moderate voices that have been silenced since Raviraj's murder back in November 2006 is shocking. It's easy to forget people like Raviraj and his efforts to transform this senseless conflict, for his death to become just another statistic. But I continue to remember him today.
Maybe his voice is no longer heard, but that is heard loudly, even in his death. That's what I can say.
நாங்கள் எல்லாரும் புதுவாழ்வு வாழவன் ஏன்னா நீங்களாம் நாளைக்கு வளர்ந்து பெரிய ஆட்களாக வாராங்க நாங்கள் எல்லாம் செத்து போயிடுவோம் நல்லா படிக்கவன் அதுக்காகத்தான் நாங்கள் எல்லாரும் உங்களோட சேர்ந்து நாங்கள் வேலை சொல்றதுதான் நீ வந்திருக்கோம் யாழ்ப்பாணத்திலையும் வடப்பாணத்திலையும் உங்களை மாதிரி பிள்ளைகள் கணக்க பேர் இருக்கிறோம் ஆனால் நாங்கள் வடக்கும் கிழக்கும் ஒற்றுமையா வாழ வேணும் தமிழ் மக்கள் எல்லாரும் நல்ல ஒற்றுமையா இருக்கோம் தான் நாங்கள் அங்கே இருந்து